I must begin with a challenge. In 92, European unification took the wrong turn. And I shall explain myself somewhere between now and the 20 minutes I'm given. But I start with this week, obviously. I watched a scene this week between the Prime Minister of Global Britain and the President of America First, deciding together that they would go back in history to the special relationship, bilateral, of course, between the United States and Britain. And I was thinking, when was the first sign of that relationship? Not in 1992. Probably before most of you were born. The Atlantic Charter of 1941, when Roosevelt and Churchill met together in the somewhere near the Atlantic Ocean to decide on fighting and winning the war together against Germany. That was the start of the special relationship, of which the one we were announced yesterday is the upside down version. And I say upside down because this week they went back in history to somewhere before the economic crisis in the 1930s. And what they are trying to destroy today is what they built between 1941 and 1949. The United States, after the Second World War, took the initiative with the Marshall Aid, with NATO, for two things that are still vital today. The one is they started Marshall Aid to European countries, Western Germany included, on condition of multilateral cooperation in distributing the aid. Multilateralism in NATO and in the OEEC has been the foundation stone of what happened later in Europe itself. It is important to keep in mind American leadership, multilateral cooperation were the basis, the context in which Europe could start to develop. And then, of course, that special relationship already diverged a little bit. The United States was quite clear that for a post-war peaceful order, Europe had to be united. The British, from Macmillan to Theresa May, never made up their mind on what their relationship should be with Europe. There is a nice joke, which I think I should tell you. When Britain came in, and now that Britain is going out, what is the difference? Well, when Britain was in, they were in with one leg and the other one out. Now it will be the other way around. Okay. There is another interesting joke which I add immediately. What was the principal task of NATO and the OEEC? Quite simply, to keep America in, the Soviets out, and Germany under. Well, the two first are still extremely important and are very much in question. The other one, we have another version of upside down, which I shall come back to in a few minutes. But let me start with this special relationship. Europe would not have been able to unite if the United States had not given the protection and the idea to work multilaterally. I even go a step further. Schuman did something absolutely unthought of at the time, reconciliation with Western Germany as the basis for the post-war European order. It would not have been possible if George Marshall and Dean Acheson had not done the same a few years before. It were the Americans, first of all, who said that Europe should be united based on reconciliation. The problem with the British, and we have to talk a lot about the British, is that that basic turn to reconciliation still has not been taken in Britain. The other one is that the British, and that is also important to see that throughout, the British had finally came in the 1970s purely for trade reasons. They never accepted the political purposes of European unification. So in a way, it may well be that Brexit can turn out to be a blessing for European integration. I'm not so sure, because what happened in Europe since that shining Christmas ball is not very encouraging. I go a little bit in history in the time given, but let me quickly go over the most important point. The American connection, understood. What Schuman did in 1950 was, from both a moral and a political point of view, a fundamental change we are still living with today. The three basic thoughts, and in fact, I would urge you sometime during this day to read the Schuman Declaration again. Margriet is certainly going to talk more about him, that's why I shall be short. It is one of the most important pieces of history. The three things Schuman underlined, and it's important to keep that in mind today: reconciliation as a permanent process, solidarity as a permanent mission, and unity as a necessary build-up for making European integration. If we look at the history, you see a number of interesting things. The British never made up their mind, and they were a pain in the neck from 1973 up to this day, let's face it. The French, like good Cartesians, they are of two minds. There is the mind of Schuman, and later came the mind of Charles de Gaulle. Charles de Gaulle can in Europe be compared a little bit to Trump today. That is, when he speaks about we and about America, or we and France, both persons meant me. They are different in character, but it's important. And why I mentioned de Gaulle, because with de Gaulle, European integration took its first wrong turn. In 1954, the French National Assembly, with the Gaullists very much behind it, rejected the European Defence Community Treaty, which I think was, looking back at it today, was a major setback. Because it is quite clear that if you want to unite a number of countries, it is not important that you all have the same size of bottles, as apparently that as Europe is about today, but it is important that you can defend yourself against outside threats. Europe, in the mind of Schuman, which I always agreed, needed a federal structure in order to do together what is necessary, and in order not to do together what can just as well be left to member states. We have, at the moment, completely lost that conception. And I think that is the principal problem of Europe today. First setback, as I said, was defense. And we are still today irresponsible as Europeans in dealing with our defense. Important. Second one, solidarity. Solidarity means that you are willing to come to each other's assistance in meeting problems. We have seen in the migrant crisis what lack of solidarity has as consequences for Europe. We have learned how lack of solidarity makes it impossible to solve the financial problems for countries like Greece, Spain, and Portugal. De Gaulle brought us another initiative that is, in my opinion, one of the further and the most persistent wrong turns. What De Gaulle introduced was very simply the following. He said, well, all these international, these supranational institutions, they cannot rule us. Only we, that is to say me, is able to rule Europe. So he invented the bad idea of summit conferences. In his mind, the summit conference would be the French president surrounded by modest prime ministers of the others, which he would then order how to do it. It didn't work out that way, as you all know. In the crisis of the 60s, it meant that De Gaulle kept Britain out. Maybe today we are not that unhappy about it. He tried to replace the communities by political union, and it didn't work. But what happened thereafter? In 1969, when De Gaulle was succeeded by Pompidou, in the Hague summit, we decided to keep the most important of De Gaulle's ideas alive, summitry. And the greatest disease of the European Union today, in my opinion, is that we think that if difficult decisions are to be taken, you must go to a meeting of the 27 prima donnas, who in public will take the good decisions, which they never do. The wrong turn in Europe, apart from the defense, in my opinion, is that we have gradually built up a Europe based on everything has to be decided at the top. And I don't know if you have ever read the conclusions of the summit conferences, or as it is called, the European Council today. You can find them on my website all the way. And it is sad reading. A lot of declarations with no consequence, and a lot of decisions nobody clearly understands. So if we want to talk about correcting where we went wrong, I would say first we have to defend ourselves, and secondly we have to replace summitry by proper federal structure. Well, that brings me to a third point, that is Maastricht. Maastricht, which apparently made a lot of people happy, in my analysis, is where Europe definitely took the wrong turn. It institutionalized summitry in the European Council. It accepted the fact that we all are in the same union, but we can continue without having the same purpose. The British were allowed to opt out in all kinds of things. And we did two things which are bothering us today. That is to say, we completed officially the internal market and we started European Monetary Union. The problem with the internal market is that we end up in the kind of situations you mentioned earlier. If you don't agree on basic purposes, you continue to make silly regulations. I'm sorry to say it as the way it is, but that's what's happening. You see, we are having endless regulations on details, and there is no basic agreement on where we go as Europe. It is also sad to say that the British are primarily co-responsible for it. They wanted the internal market without European unity. And the result is where we are today. Where we are today is that there is a fundamental disagreement within the European Union on where we go, and there is an endless number of details on which there are regulations. So Britain pointed to a problem largely self-made we are all faced with. Since Maastricht, There is another way where I think Maastricht turned the wrong way. Maastricht happened in 1991. 1991 was the time in which we lived through this absolutely fascinating process of the collapse of the communist system. I'm very glad, Piotr, you are here. I always tell my students and also tell you, Europe could be reunited thanks to Solidarność and John Paul II. I always, when I talk about Europe on a more than political level, I always bring that in. Robert Schuman and Solidarność, John Paul II, dealt with Europe from a profoundly Christian moral point of view. What they have in common is that their conscience, their Christian conscience, revolted against the ruins they had seen, the ruins of the Second World War for Schuman, the ruins of communist totalitarian rule for Solidarność, and they decided we must do it differently. If good things have happened in Europe over the years, I think we must very carefully look at Schuman and Solidarność to understand where the inspiration came from. That means, I should look at my time, that means that there is a deeper reason why the European Union at the moment is in a crisis. It is the crisis in its relationship with the United States. It is the crisis with respect to the three principles Schuman mentioned, and Solidarność, of course, confirmed: unity, solidarity, and reconciliation. It is a crisis in the spirit, and it is a crisis that has political consequences. With Maastricht, Europe took the wrong turn. After Brexit, we may have a chance that Europe, with its spiritual tradition, will come back to its senses and start again. But we do have a problem in the meantime. 1992 also was the beginning of the kind of Europe that is today, strangely enough, challenged on the basis of two very old-fashioned ideas: nationalism and populism. The problem is that the special relationship established this week was established by two populists and two nationalists. In the Netherlands and in most of our countries in Europe, populists and nationalists are still a rather small minority, but they may be stimulated by Theresa May and Donald Trump to do the same thing with their own country. And I think that the lesson I can draw from history, and I mean, I should have talked about that history for about a day with you, but the lessons I could draw from it are, in fact, two. The first one is, we Europeans need to revive our Christian conscience to find out what is to be done in this very serious crisis we are in at the moment. Number two, the step-by-step approach originally invented by Jean Monnet and put in political terms by Schuman works only if it is going towards a united purpose. In philosophy, and today on St. Thomas' feast day, it's good to at least refer to it, we must agree on what common good is on a European level to be pursued. step by step only if it leads somewhere. Third, and that is a challenge to the next speaker, differentiated Europe means more and more divergence. If you differentiate, it is not a way to reach the same goal at different times. It is a way to get increasingly different goals. If you look at the financial side, it means divergence rather than convergence. But that's a challenge to you. That's my second point. The third point is we must be aware of that strange mood called populism, that at a time where Europe, in historical terms, has been relatively successful, despite all the mistakes and all the things I mentioned, that we have strong voices, also in this country, are arguing in favor of a return to nationalism, as if they haven't learned from history that nationalism means war. Last point, I mentioned already, apart from the conscience, unity. If we want unity, there is no alternative to decent, sensible federal institutions. Forget about summits and look for good people who can govern whatever needs to be governed together on a supranational federal level. Thank you.